Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by ICOM. For more information, visit ICOMAmerica.com/HamNation and by DX Engineering. DX Engineering offers practically everything you need to outfit your shack, plus the fastest shipping in the industry. In-stock items ship the same day, Monday through Friday until 10 p.m. Eastern. For more information, visit DXEngineering.com/HamNation and by LegalZoom. Visit LegalZoom.com to save on your legal needs and gain access to a network of legal plan attorneys for guidance. LegalZoom is not a law firm, but provides self-help services at your specific direction. Visit LegalZoom.com and use offer code HamNation to receive $10 off at checkout. This is Ham Nation, episode number 156, July 16th, 2014. The ARRL at 100. Hey, good evening, everyone. It's Ham Nation. This is a show about ham radio, put together by ham radio operators, for ham radio operators, people who want to be ham radio operators, and the people who love them. And that should just about cover everybody, I do believe. Yes, and we're patriotic as well. Good evening. I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW, from deep in the heart of South Louisiana. We've got, basically the children have taken over the asylum tonight because Bob and Gordon are out. I believe they're both at the ARRL Centennial, and we're going to check in with some folks who actually visited the ARRL headquarters and W1AW a little bit later on. We have Al and Mike, a couple of our net controls, on with us. But let's head a couple of hours to my north and see what's going on in Jackson, Mississippi. George, what's going on up there, Chief?
Hi, Don. It's good to be back this week. I was in Houston, Texas last week helping my son get the antenna up on his HF station. So we got that accomplished, and good to be back.
Excellent. For those of you who may not know, of course, I think we all know that that George is a drummer, but your son has a band out there. Give them a plug. What's the name of the band?
Yeah, the name of the band is Big Richard, and they play all over the South. They play around Texas, Oklahoma, Mississippi, Florida. They're on the road almost every weekend. So could be in a town near you. It's BigRichard.com.
Cool. You'll have to let me know when they're down here in Mississippi. We'll see if we can't head up to Jackson and go see them. Or maybe if they're down on the coast or near New Orleans, we'll go check them out. Let's head over towards Colorado now, because there's Big Richard, or at least his website. Yeah. And let's see what Amanda's going on tonight over in Colorado. How are you, darling? You're looking lovely in your pink.
Well, thank you. Glad to be here tonight. And boy, I know the ARRL Centennial. Everybody's there and not me. Not you either, I guess. Anyhow, you guys, make sure you get on chat tonight. Give me your questions. And also, tell me if you've upgraded or if you just got your license, or anybody you know just got their license. I like to congratulate those people on the air. So if you do that, I would be appreciative. I'll send it back to you, Don.
All right. Well, I've got some interesting news. My son, when I got home from work today, because Emmett from Radio Waves Antenna and I were hounding him on Facebook today about studying for his license. A couple of years ago, I got the Gordon West technician manual for him and I had Gordon sign it. And I come home from work today and he's like, Dad, I can't find the Gordon West book. So that's okay, son. I have another copy. So he's actually in there, I think, studying. At least he had the book open. So we'll see. Slidell, cool. Louisiana Ham Fest is this coming weekend in Slidell, Louisiana. W5SLA is the call sign for the club, Whiskey 5 Sierra Lima Alpha. So if you want to Google them and check out W5SLA, that is the Ozone Amateur Radio Club, Slidell, Louisiana, near New Orleans, VE test, and I'm going to be one of the VEs there. So I'm looking forward to that. Now, we just concluded WRTC, and the U.S. took the gold. Germany took the bronze, so I guess that kind of makes up for World Cup a little bit. George, don't you have something on the WRTC for us tonight?
Actually, I do, Don. This is a video that came to us. Tim forwarded, Tim Duffy, K3LR, and they've got some others we'll be looking at in the future, but right now we've got one with Lena from Germany.
Hi, I'm Lena, DLADYL. I come from Germany, and I was part on the WRTC YL team. This weekend.
Did you have a lot of fun at this WRTC? And why?
I had a lot of fun because at first I met so many people from all around the world. I already had contacts with most of them on the bands. And now I met him here. A to A, and I had fun during the contest.
Did you have any difficulty working multipliers, breaking pileups, working HQ stations? What was the most difficult part of the whole operation?
During the contest, we had no problems with our technicians. Everything was well, no breakdown or something like this. It was quite difficult to work on 10 meters because we think there was no real opening. And on the other hand, on 80 meters, it was a great challenge to get all the HQ stations we could hear. It took me sometimes a long time to get through, but every multiplier we said, yeah, and we are funny about this, and this was good.
What was your most memorable multiplier? What is the one you remember the most, the best multiplier you cracked?
Oh, I don't remember, but all multipliers on 80 I worked, so... Yeah. I was the 80 multiplier guy, so...
Tell me about your referee, Rusty. Rusty is very well known in the contesting community. How was your referee? Was he helpful? Did he stay back? Did he not interfere? Tell me about your referee.
Rusty, our referee, I think he's a really, really nice guy, and I loved him the first time I met him. And he made us feel comfortable all the day and all the night and something like this. He helped us with water and opened the windows at the tent or closed and something like this. And he always said, you are doing great and you are in the best way. And that was what we need. So it was a good referee. I think the best referee ever we could have.
That's great. Okay. Did you have trouble being in a tent for 24 hours? I know it's not easy to be in a tent. It's like field day.
Yeah.
Was it uncomfortable? Was it comfortable? Were you okay? Or did you think after a while, I want to go home, I don't want to be here, or were you okay?
I never did this field day style operation before. We had always some mobile home or something like this for field day, so it was the first time 24 hours in a tent. Especially on the daytime on Saturday, it was so hot and I get some headache and something like this. And I didn't know if I can make it during the 24 hours. So it was not such good, but when it came cool down in the evening, I feel better and it was okay. In the morning, it's getting a little bit cold, so we've had all clothes down and the blanket and something like this. I think it looks a little bit funny, but I think it's okay. And then it's getting warmer again.
Yeah, you looked like you were all bundled up there.
Yeah.
So. Okay. Did you look at your surroundings, the place where you were operating from?
Mm.
It's a very strange place, you know. It's an old hospital. Did you take a look at your surroundings at all, or you just went straight to your site? Because this is a very... You know where you were, right?
Yeah, at the medical site.
It's a very... They shoot movies there.
Oh.
Yeah, it's a very spooky place. I wonder if you... Never mind, I won't ask you about that. Anyway, last question. Your personal feelings on being here at WRTC. Has this been a really great experience? Has it been as you expected, or has it been much more than you expected? What's the best thing about WRTC for you?
The best thing about WRTC, I don't know where to start and where to end, because I was nervous at the beginning. I didn't really know what to expect at this weekend, but all the people were so nice and so friendly, so it makes much more easier for us. And the competition also was great. I was surprised to have so huge pileups with only 100 watts, because this is not my favorite power output at contest. But when we had the pile-ups, then we feel great and we had a lot of fun. And at the end, we think it's a good score, and so
we're really
happy.
Thank you so much. That was perfect.
Thank you, too.
Well, as I mentioned, we've got some more videos that Dale will be bringing to us in the future on that. And he's going to be with us a little bit later this evening. But right now, I think we need to get a message from Don. With Al and Mike.
Yeah, we've got some guests. We have our 40 meter and 20 meter net controllers, Al and Mike. They are out. Mike is actually out from California, and he's visiting Al. I guess these guys are going to go to check out the ARRL 100. Bring those guys up and let's see what's going on over at over at Al's QTH. Al and Mike, we're going to talk to them a little bit. And we've got a neat slideshow that we're going to get to in a little bit. Hey, guys, how are we?
We're great. Yeah, hello, Mike's out here from California to see the centennial at the ARRL headquarters, which is like an hour from my house. It takes me longer to get to my office than it does to get to ARRL headquarters. So it's great to have a big event going on that's right down the street, really.
Yeah, and it's, of course, the ARRL centennial. I think the actual 100th anniversary of the ARRL was on the last day, the Sunday of Dayton. But, of course, they're having the big centennial convention coming up. I believe it starts tomorrow. It's this weekend. And so tell us a little bit about what you guys are going to be doing over there. I know you went and you actually did a visit to W1AW today. We can roll that video now. And Al, if you'll narrate over it and tell us what we're looking at.
All right, I'll try and do that. It's fast. It's going to go by quickly, so we'll have a look here. And there's some audio on it, too. So, we went to the ARRL. We thought we'd get there before the crowds of the centennial. This is the lobby at the ARRL. And by the way, the nicest people, every person at the ARRL was treated us so well, and the tour is a lot of fun. Here's Mike looking at, there's a Valiant, some early Collins gear, a Heathkit tour. I told him this was quick. Arc 5, got some communicators, and there's Gary. He was our tour guide, and he showed us everything at the ARRL. W1FH, the first DXCC. Here's some audio.
Yes.
That's Harold Kramer, the chief officer.
Nice to meet you, Harold.
We met with Harold for a bit. This is the QSL, outgoing QSL Bureau. Here's some emergency equipment. These are the packages they put together and send out to areas where when they're needed with ham aid, and this is where they keep them. They're getting ready for card checking at the Centennial. They've got all sorts of positions. I expect a lot of people to do that. There's Oscar, not the actual one, but a backup, but there's the D-Star repeater. Here's a room that has just about every piece of ham gear ever. You should be able to find the rig you started ham radio. 75A4, serial number 1 right there.
Calling WBC.
Here's audio on this.
Or K9EID. Here is Whiskey Tango 6 Hotel at ARRL headquarters.
There you go. That's Mike with Bob and Joe's rig. Here's the ARRL lab and some people hard at work testing things. And we're going to show you the RF-proof room in a second. There's Oscar again, first ham satellite. And there it is. Everyone goes into this RF-proof room and sees if their cell phone gets any bars. Of course, they don't. Gil Gildersleeve, W1CJD, did those wonderful cartoons. And they have a great exhibit of the cartoons that appeared in QST. This is the club station for the employees at the ARRL. That's the graphics department. There's a preview of a story that's going to be in the September issue. All right, so then we walked over to W1AW. And right here, this is the man who's responsible for the convention and the centennial. There's Joe Carcia, the station manager at W1AW. He's getting various operating positions ready. Now there's Mike. He's operating 15-meter sideband. And I was sitting right next to him operating 17-meter sideband with W100AW. And that was a great thrill. Yeah. It really was. We're almost 2 hours. We operated W100AW, worked a lot of stations. We were primarily concentrating, I think, on European stations. And we just had a great time. And that's the end of the show. And then at the end, we got these. I'll show you the certificate. Here's the certificate we got for... I don't know if you can see it, for operating W100AW from headquarters. And just a great thrill. And everyone at the ARRL, without exception, was super to us. They treated us very well. And whatever we wanted to do, anything we wanted to see, they just brought it right up and did it for us. So it was a great time.
Man, what a thrill. What a thrill. Now, anyone listening to your voice can tell that you have a broadcast background. How long were you in radio, Al?
About 30 years. I started in the late 60s, 69, 70, somewhere in there. And I can't even tell you how many radio stations I worked at. a lot, many. some major market. I managed to work in Manhattan. I worked at CBS FM. That's an oldie station. Connecticut, Long Island, New York, for the most part.
Very cool. Yeah, the radio people can relate to that. You don't think about stuff by year. You think about, well, let's see, that was when I was at NBC. Now that was when I was at KOFM, and that was when I was at KOMA.
That's right.
It's funny. That's how 38 years or 36 years of my life is chronicled anyway. Yeah. Now, when did you get into amateur radio? Because that was obviously before you got into broadcasting, right?
Way before. And I'll tell you, it's a story that it just makes me feel good thinking back to it. 55 years ago, I was 12 years old. I was in the seventh grade, and I made a new friend in the seventh grade, and he said, my dad bought me this shortwave radio receiver, and you just got to come over after school because I can hear Radio Moscow all the way to Russia, you know, and it was a helicopter, S-38E, I think, very much like the one you see on Dale's desk when he'll be on later tonight. I think you'll see the receiver. And that was Ed Little. I don't think he's a ham anymore. His call was K1LNA. I remember that. We were friends for quite some time. And I think he's the Episcopal Bishop of Northern Indiana, I hear, although I haven't talked to him in years. And we went over to his house, and I heard Radio Moscow, and I was just hooked. And then he told me, you know, you can transmit. And he showed me this book that cost 50 cents. It was called The Radio Amateur's License Manual for the ARRL. So every day after school, in study halls, every spare second, we practiced the code. We talked to each other in code in class and studied the license manual together and got our license in the summer of, I got my license in the summer of 1959, June 24th. And wow. I've been a ham ever since, and I've never really had a period of inactivity.
That is very cool. Okay, now, you're on the 40-meter net. You're going to be doing that from your house. Mike is on the 20-meter net. Normally, he does that from California, and by the magic and technology of remote control, you're still going to be doing it from the West Coast, from the East Coast. Is that right, Mike? Tell me about that.
Yeah. Yes, we will actually both be on 40 meters, Don, as Steve, W7UDI, runs the 20-meter net from Washington
State.
That's right.
So that's right.
Me and Al, usually we switch off, and with Dale, and we'll have Amanda on tonight, all on 40 meters. I'll be running 100 watts only tonight with my TS-480 and remote rig using the internet and the remote rig interface from California from here. And we'll also be using Al's radio here with the big tower and the step IR here from Danbury, Connecticut. I tell you, I'm so looking forward to this here tonight. And of course, with Al's hospitality of letting me stay here the past couple nights. And
did you tell him where you're staying? He's staying in the driveway in my motorhome.
So,
hey, I've done that.
Accommodations.
Yeah.
I got my own mobile apartment out front there. And looking forward to representing Gilroy and Ham Nation this year at it's once in a lifetime, the 100th. The ARRL Centennial Convention here starting tomorrow.
One of the things I'm looking forward to with the 40-meter net is for Mike to see what it's like to stay up and do the net till midnight or 1 in the morning.
It's late.
Yeah,
already.
That's right. Yeah.
I know.
Yeah. Three-hour time difference. That's right.
Now, but when do you see what he looks like at 1 in the morning when we're finishing up the net?
And then we got to get up at 4 in the morning and get ready for the convention.
Yeah, I'm going to Contest University.
I'm going to the RFI seminar.
Well, you may as well just stay up and just make a whole, just make an experience of it then.
Yeah, I'm thinking about just staying up.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah, just put on a huge pot of coffee and just jump into it. Guys, thank you so much for being with us tonight. We really appreciate it. It's neat to see you guys in the same place instead of being bi-coastal. So, Mike, W6TH, or WT6H, rather, and Al, K1LTJ. Guys, thank you so much for being on Ham Nation with us tonight. We appreciate it. And appreciate all you do for the Nets, too.
Okay, thanks, Don.
Yeah, thanks, Don.
All right, let's bring it back now, and we'll get a little word from our friends at ICOM.
Some great D-Star radios have entered the market in the last year, but let's not forget all the solid analog radios out there. From radios strictly on 2 meters to dual banders with analog capability, ICOM has your complete analog solution. Check out ICOM's compact military rugged 2-meter IC23H mobile. 65 watts of stable output. Oversized tuning dial is easy to use. It's got 4.5 watts of loud audio, 207 memory channels, and multiple scan options. Consider the ICV8000 for your next mobile adventure on 2 meters, 75 watts of output power, a rugged die-cast aluminum chassis, and fast memory scanning with dynamic memory scan. ICOM's new ID5100A is a VHF-UHF dual-pan transceiver with built-in D-Star. It's got a large 5.5-inch touchscreen with software keypad and SD card slot, 50 watts of output on both VHF and UHF, integrated GPS receiver, simultaneous to-receive capability, and an optional UT133 Bluetooth unit that supports hands-free communications and an Android app. Looking for rugged, easy-to-use handhelds with plenty of memory channels, loud audio, and long-lasting battery life? The ICV80 and the V80HD is a 2-meter handheld with 5.5 watts of high power. A built-in BTL amplifier helps deliver 750 milliwatts of loud audio, and the HD version includes radio, lithium-ion battery pack, and a rapid charger for up to 19 hours of operation. The ICT70AHD is a dual-band transceiver for classic operation on 2 meters and 70 centimeters. Like the V80HD, this version includes the radio, lithium-ion battery pack, and the rapid charger for up to 19 hours of operation. It's easy to program with a simple keypad, large backlit alphanumeric display, and it has 700 milliwatts of loud and clear audio. Why not take a look today? Visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM's analog ham radio selection. And you can tune in and enter to win after each episode of Ham Nation. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation and throw your name in the hat for some great swag prizes from the ICOM swag store. They've got hats, T-shirts, just all kinds of stuff in there, and you could win. And not only that, you'll be registered for the monthly giveaway, which is always a radio. And the July grand prize is going to be the ICOM ID51A, a full-featured dual-watch VHF-UHF handheld with D-Star, integrated GPS, automatic repeater list-up, and more. So go to icomamerica.com/hamnation after this episode and every episode of Ham Nation and enter to win. And here's a picture right here of the 50th anniversary edition specials of the ID51A. No word on when these will be available or the pricing yet, but check with your ICOM dealer. They'll be coming your way soon. Right now, let's get on into smoke and solder. You know, when I was on here 2 weeks ago, I showed you my field day setup, and one of the items I had on my desk there is something I had built. So let's take a look at that. For field day this year, I used my IC7000 as my primary rig, and that rig's got a voice keyer built in, so I made an external keypad to kind of speed up operation. On page 135 of the manual, we find the diagram for building an external keypad. Two connections to the mic connector, pin 7 and pin 2. We've got four push buttons, and we've got four resistors here, a 4.7K, a 2.2K, and a couple of 1.5Ks. Now, this is basically a voltage divider. Depending on which switch we push, determines how much voltage will go to the mic connector here. So, fairly simple. Here's a diagram on the mic connector itself. My rig came with an HM151 microphone. We can see pin 7 is ground, and pin 2 is the frequency up and down buttons. The reason I looked up the connector information here is the microphone has a separate ground lead, and we want the microphone lead itself to be shielded. Pin 1 is 8 volts DC, pin 2 is frequency up and down, pin 3 is M8VSW, which I'm not sure what that is, but doesn't matter. Pin 4 is our push-to-talk, pin 5 is the microphone ground, so we'll use the shield of a shielded cable here connected to that. Pin 6 is the microphone input, so the wire inside the shielded cable will be the one we use for that. Pin 7, ground, and pin 8, data in. So basically what I need to do is just loop all of these through and then tap off for the ones that we need. Here's the box I chose to build my external keypad in. It was something else in a previous life, but I've relabeled it, and we're going to build into this. And here's my completed circuit here. It's already been built at this stage. I lost the footage of when I was building it. That's what I really wanted to show you. You can see I've got an RJ45 connector here that I've got a piece of Cat5 cable hooked to. It's stranded Cat5 cable in there instead of just the solid wires. And you can't see it, but I've also got a piece of mini shielded cable up in there that's running to the connectors for the microphone input. And I put both of those cables inside a piece of heat shrink tubing here. I didn't shrink it down. I just left it normal there. Here's the Cat5 cable, and you can see the various wires coming out of here. And here's a little piece of shielded cable that I had. I only needed 6 wires out of the Cat5 cable, so I clipped off 2, and we hooked them to all the pins except the microphone ground and the microphone input. And I hooked the shielded wires to those 2. Inside here, I've got a connector where I'll plug my microphone in once this is done. I used my hot knife and cut out a square there, mounted the connector inside, and then I used a little bit of hot glue to secure it. I took each one of the wires coming here from our Cat5 cable and disconnected them to the same pin over here on this female connector. And you can see I've got the shielded cable here that was used for the microphone connections, but I also took a jumper off of that and ran over here to an XLR connector where I could plug in an external microphone if I wanted to use something different. And you can see I also have a 1/4-inch connector here. I took that and ran that in parallel with the push-to-talk line here on the microphone, but you can see I also jumpered it up here to a button by itself, so I can use this as a push-to-talk if I would like. These first 4 buttons here are the ones that are going to be used for the voice keyer. You can see I took the resistors here, and I put them in between the push buttons, exactly as was in the drawing. And I connected ground to one side of all these push buttons. That's pretty much it. Let's just take a look at the schematic of what I did, because I know this might be a little confusing to look at right here, but trust me, it worked great during field day, and I used a China marker, or some people might call them a grease pencil, just to temporarily put in legends here for what I programmed each of the memories for in my radio. And I can just rub those off and change it to something else if I want to use a different voice. Now, here's a schematic of our box. Pin number 1 just goes straight through from a male RJ45 connector that goes to the radio, on over to a female one that was mounted on the rear of the box. Pin 2 is the one that we're actually going to hook our keyer to, so we come from the radio and go down to our voltage divider network of resistors here, along with the push buttons, which come on back up to pin 7, which is ground, and that one just goes straight through. Pin 3 here goes straight through, the same with pin 4. Pin 5 is a microphone ground, and you can see we connected the shield of our shielded cable to pin 5. Pin 6 is the microphone audio, so that just goes straight through on the shielded cable. Pin 7 is ground, and you can see we've got it going straight through. And pin 8 goes straight through as well. Now, I added a couple other features to this to make it a little more interesting. For push to talk, I tapped off of that, and I've got a switch in the box that I can press to do push-to-talk with, but I also have a jack here on the side that I can plug in a foot switch or an external handheld push-to-talk button if I would like to. Over on the audio, you can see I connected the shield on down to pin 1 and 3 of an XLR connector, and I connected pin 6, which is the microphone audio, to pin 2. Now I can plug in an external microphone and use it with a rig if I'd like to. So that's pretty much it. The simple little external keyer for use with the IC7000. Now, this might work with some other ICOM rigs. You'd have to check. And there are probably other brands of rigs out there that have voice keyers built in that would use a similar interface. Check your documentation to be sure. And as I mentioned, that really worked good, although I didn't use it that much during field day because I was only running 100 watts on a wire antenna, and other people already had the frequencies tied up, but I did use it a little bit. You know, I showed you that video a couple of weeks ago of my field day setup there. Well, I've got more on that. If you'd like to see it, we just put out the latest episode of Amateur Logic this week. Go over to amateurlogic.tv and check that out. And it wasn't last week. It was 2 weeks ago because I wasn't here last week. But I asked a question, what frequency was on my rig during that field day episode? And I had a winner there. It's Chris Van Winkle, KC3CBL. And he said, hi, George. Your rig was on frequency 21.275.50. Well, congratulations, Chris. You're going to win this Chameleon CHA hybrid micro antenna. It's a 60-foot-long antenna that is claimed to work from 1.8 to 54 megahertz. Really nice-looking. I guess it's a balun. I'm not sure what's in there to make 60 feet of wire work. But really nice-looking. I have not tried it, so don't know anything about the performance of it. But maybe Chris will let us know. So congratulations, Chris. That'll be coming your way this week. For next week, we've got another prize here from DX Engineering. And it's another one of these DXE-281 extension speakers. Nice little external speaker to hook up to your mobile rig or even your base rig. If you'd like to win that, then answer this. What is the total approximate length of a dipole antenna for 3.8 megahertz? If you think you know the answer, send it to me at hamnationcontest@gmail.com, and you could be next week's lucky winner. And right now, I think it's time for a little bit of news.
From Amateur Radio Newsline Report, number 1926, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, July 16th, 2014. As Gordon West, WB6NOA, told us last week, the Hawaii to California tropo duct is alive and well. It was recorded by Wayne Overbeck, N6NB. He also made some voice contacts. On Saturday, July 5th, Fred Honold, KH7Y, made the five-hour round trip from his home to the beacon site on Hawaii's Mauna Loa volcano. He worked a number of California stations on 144, 223.5, and 432 megahertz with excellent signals. Here's a sample of N6NB's QSO with KH7Y at the KH6HME station on 223.5 over a path of 2,505 miles.
I think it's 15 watts, 10 or 15 watts. 15 watts on 223.5. Oh my goodness. Well, I'm running a transverter and about 100 watts out on 223.5. KH6HME from N6NB, DM13. Over.
KH7Y was signing KH6HME in honor of the late Paul Lieb, who made this path famous. Other trans-Pacific openings are being reported, and we'll have more on those next week. Another successful ham satellite launch is in the books and on the air. Jim Davis, W2JKD, has more.
The UQ1 ham radio satellite was successfully launched on Tuesday, July 8th from Kazakhstan. The UQ control team and radio amateurs across Europe awaited the satellite coming within range. Its 145.84 megahertz beacon signal was received by the satellite's control team at 1916 UTC. Signals have also been received from DX1 and Tech EdSat, which rode to orbit on the same launch as UQ1.
The Hurricane WatchNet was activated twice during Hurricane Arthur.
The first activation came on July the 3rd as the storm was headed towards North Carolina's Outer Banks. It made landfall at 11:15 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time with a maximum sustained wind of 100 miles per hour, damaging homes and cutting off island communities from the mainland.
As Hurricane Arthur continues to develop, the threat for sustained high winds may increase soon. The latest area forecast for maximum winds of 70 to 90 miles per hour with gusts to 110 miles per hour.
Arthur made the North Carolina coastline as a Category 1 hurricane and remained that way as it worked its way northward along the eastern seaboard. This accounted for a second activation on July 5th before Arthur deteriorated into a tropical storm as it neared Canada.
Net operations on the high-frequency bands were on 14.325 megahertz and 7.268 megahertz, depending on propagation. The VOIP Hurricane WatchNet could be monitored on several Echolink nodes, IRLP, and other monitoring services worldwide. Both Skywarn and the United States and CanWarn in Canada were involved in this first hurricane call-out of the 2014 season.
And finally this week, the recently concluded European Ham Radio Convention held in Friedrichshafen, Germany, is a major success. Attendance was up by some 1,800 attendees over 2013. Specific numbers say this year's crowd hit 17,100. Again, here's Jim Davis.
One of those attending from the United States was CQ Magazine's kit-building columnist Joe Eisenberg, K0NEB. He was there with a group representing the Dayton Hamvention.
They added a maker fair in one of the halls. So you had a lot of the makers who were not only making radios and stuff, but they were also modifying computers and using 3D printers and all the interesting things that makers do. So that was a great addition to the convention.
According to K0NEB, the show attracted people from all over the world, and it was as much of a social gathering as it was a trade show.
I would say in the main exhibit hall, about 50% of the space is actually clubs and organizations, and it was a great way to get to know people from all over Europe and actually all over the world. There were clubs as far away as Thailand that had booths. I was in the DARA booth, which was the Dayton Amateur Radio Association. Of course, we were promoting the Dayton Hamvention and DARA.
Joe says it was a great experience that he tried to capture in another of his slideshow presentations. Go to YouTube and search Joe Husker to see this and all of his presentations. Click on the subscribe button as Joe adds new things all the time. And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news brought to you each and every week for over 35 years and counting at www.arnewsline.org. I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW73. We'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. And I'm pretty sure that Joe is going to be at the ARRL 100th Centennial in Hartford, Connecticut that starts tomorrow. And I'll tell you who else is going to be there, and that's DX Engineering. They're going to be there to wish the league a happy 100th to the largest amateur radio organization in the country. And if you're headed up to Connecticut for the 100th, be sure to stop by the DX Engineering booth. Going to be a lot of stuff for you to see. Some of the new products that they unveiled at Dayton will be there. So if you missed Dayton, you can go to the ARRL 100th and see the new products starting tomorrow, like the DX Engineering Receive Guard 5000 to protect your receiver's receive-only port against high receive input RF levels. Also, the DX Engineering Rotator Control Line Protector, copper ground clamp. If you've got the DX Engineering NCC1 Receive Phasing Unit, they'll have new optional receive filters there tomorrow as well. And all weekend, they'll help you reduce frequency-specific noise and improve your signal reception. The big news, though, is going to be, of course, the special show discounts. Get the DX Engineering booth and grab an exclusive coupon good for $10 off your order of $100 or more. It's good only with a DX Engineering coupon, so make sure you get over to the booth early and get the coupon. And if you're not going to make it to Hartford, you can still take advantage of special weekly deals online at dxengineering.com. Of course, DX Engineering understands the key role that the league and its members play in the advancement of the amateur radio. The whole hobby, the service, organizations like the ARRL and affiliated local clubs are the bedrock foundation of our hobby. And if you're not an ARRL member, well, you really should think about joining. And if you are a member, thank you. The DX Engineering team hopes to see you at the ARRL Centennial Convention starting tomorrow in Hartford. And if you want to grab any of this gear, get your order in by 10 p.m. Eastern tonight. If it's in stock, DX Engineering will put it on a truck. It'll head your way tonight with proven products, expert advice, the fastest shipping in the industry. DX Engineering helps you shrink the globe. Get your catalog or shop online 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at dxengineering.com/hamnation. And DX Engineering, thank you so much for your support of this fine program coming to a computer near you right now, as a matter of fact. Let's go see what Dale has got going on. He's over in Kansas, where the land is flat and the waves of wheat. I don't know what I'm trying to say. Dale, I have no idea what I'm
saying. Well, that's all right, Don. We've got a lot of ground to cover. 6 field day videos for you. 2, by the way, from professional videographers. And we'll get things rolling real quick with a report from David Mize. He's with the Tuscaloosa Amateur Radio Club down in Alabama. We'll be right back.
4 X-ray India.
Whiskey 4 X-ray India, nice signal. Please copy 2 Alpha Eastern Mass.
Yeah, copying 2 Alpha Eastern Mass. We are 2 Alpha, Alpha Lima, 2 Alpha Alabama, QSL.
Thanks for Alabama.
This operation here, you know, especially during the tornado, a lot of communications were lost, and these guys played a big part in as far as the search and rescue, as far as getting outside help, as far as letting the outside world know what was going on in our county, Tuscaloosa County.
Let's move now to Virginia and John Underwood. He has a report from the first ever field day for the Blue Ridge Wireless Amateurs at K4BRW.
Kilo 4 Bravo Romeo Whiskey.
Romeo Whiskey Station.
This is Kilo 4 Bravo Romeo Whiskey. We are 1 Alpha Virginia, 1 Alpha Virginia, QSL.
Okay, we copy 1 Alpha Virginia, Kilo 4 Bravo Romeo Whiskey. Please copy my 4 Alpha Bravo Michigan. Mike India, QSL.
QSL 4 Alpha Michigan. Thank you very much. Good luck.
Well, from the Blue Ridge Mountains, we travel south now to the Sun Coast in Florida. And here comes a report from Kevin Young. He's KC7FPF. Thank you. Next up, the Raytown Amateur Radio Club in Kansas City. They held a special event plus field day operation this year. And JD N0IRS reports on the operation at WW1 USA.
Andy Schultz, KD0HKD. I'm president of the Raytown Amateur Radio Club, also known as K0GQ. We're at our field day site, which this year is at the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial in Kansas City. We're doing this not only as field day, but in commemoration of the anniversary of the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand in Sarajevo 100 years ago, which is considered by many to be the event that triggered the start of the Great War. We're having a great time. The weather so far is cooperating, although we're told in an hour we're going to have one heck of a thunderstorm. So I'm standing outside of the trailer. That's our Goddess station. We're running Class 2A, so set up with a public UHF station where it's not, of course, collecting points, but people who want to experience a little bit of ham radio can get on a repeater with a control operator and kind of get a little taste of what it is. And, of course, the Goddess station, that's what that's all about. Like, we're having a great time. It's field day.
CQ, CQ, this is WW1 USA calling CQ, CQ at the special events here at the Liberty Memorial.
What's your favorite part of field day?
Field day is a fellowship with all ham operators all over the world.
What do you like most about field day?
I like the fun of it. I've been a ham since 2010, and I've came out every year. So I started off on Gaga, and every year I've kind of got my feet a little more wet.
My name is Joshua Hallam, and my call sign is KD0WNF.
Thanks, JD, for that report. N0DSN hosted a big field day event for hams in southern Minnesota. With the video, here's Ham Nation 40-meter post-show net regular Larry Shantz. He's WD0AKX.
Here's one of the tents that was later destroyed by high winds with the storm. But one of the stations are set up here now. The equipment was saved. They moved that in the garage ahead of time. Here you see Josh, KD0IJX, doing some logging. And the operator on the left is Mike, KB0VXN, doing some CW, Morse code.
To Alpha, Oklahoma.
Got him?
Got him.
Field day is always the fourth full weekend in June. Purpose is to get on the air, test your skills, work as many stations as you can in a 24-hour period. Kind of an emergency drill and also kind of a contest. And here's a look at one of the antennas, an off-center fed dipole and mast. Let's go inside the garage where we have two other operators operating. Let's see how they're doing.
Norway X-ray 0 pop up.
Storm's coming as usual on field day. There they are. Heading our way.
Norway X-ray 0 pop up. Norway X-ray 0 Papa.
Norway X-ray 0 Papa. 3 Alpha to Mexico,
QSL. QSL, please copy 2 Alpha Minnesota. 2 Alpha Minnesota. I need your call again, please.
Oh, sure.
I missed it.
And here on the left is the host of the event, Dustin, N0DSN. And on the right is Roger, NX0P. We use his call for field day since it's an easy call to say.
And finally this evening, we travel from Minnesota back to Virginia, where W4EDF operated on 100% solar power. With that report, here's Jerry Kalane, KF7IJZ.
Hi folks, this is KF7IJZ coming to you from Field Day 2014.
Now, does this show you impedance anywhere?
Yeah.
Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Foxtrot. Two Bravo, Victor Alpha.
All right, so Ed, what are we running today at the high power station?
We are running an Elecraft KX3 through the Elecraft KXPA100 amplifier.
The UKIT's TJ4 Alpha. It's a 40 meter, 20 meter, 15 meter, and 10 meter transceiver. Puts out 20 watts maximum.
We are operating completely 100% solar power. What you see here are two PowerFilm 120 watt foldable solar arrays. They are chained together, giving me a maximum capacity of 240 watts.
QRZ, this is Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Fox.
So over here, powering our low power QRP station at our 2 Bravo field day site is a PowerFilm 20 watt panel. This one's in black.
W4 Echo Delta Fox. Thank you to 2 Bravo VA. You are 4 Alpha Tennessee.
Sorry.
QSL, Tango, have a good night.
Same to you, sir. This is W4 Oscar Lima Bravo. You are dead. This is Echo 3 Oscar Romeo.
Whiskey 4 Echo Delta Fox.
But I just wanted to take this opportunity to kind of show folks how compact this overall package is. So these are the two 120 watt panels completely folded up. I also wanted to take the opportunity to look at what I would consider the QRP setup, kind of folded down and collapsed. You have the PowerFilm 20 watt panel there with the Genesun GV5 charge controller and the battery.
Whiskey 3, Bravo Mike Delta, QRZ.
Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Foxtrot.
Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Foxtrot, please copy 5 Alpha, Whiskey Papa Alpha, 5 Alpha, Western PA.
Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Fox.
Whiskey 4, Echo.
Whiskey 4, Echo Delta Foxtrot.
How did things go?
They went spectacular. I think with this, and in this particular situation, it gave me the opportunity to really just experiment, which to me I think is more what what I want in a field day.
And power poles. Power pole everything. Power pole the world.
And I didn't have necessarily the pressure of, all right, I got to make a lot of contacts.
What was your favorite thing about our field day?
Arguing with you about D-Star?
At the end of the day, I think that's what field day should be, is to really try out and improve upon, so that when the time comes that you really do need it, that you're doing the best. So,
with solar, I'm blown away. I came out here with what I was under the impression is an 8 amp hour battery, but after talking to mass and all that stuff, it's not an 8 amp hour battery, and it's heavy, very, very heavy. The PowerFilm 20 watt panel, it's small, it's the size of a paperback book. You know, it can fit anywhere. We had it running my HF station, my laptop, our digipeater that we had set up. It just took everything. Even when it was halfway shaded, it was still putting out 16 watts. So, really good panel. The charge controllers, that UV5, or the 5 amp one that I had, with the load on it, I thought that was really cool. That way we can do a bunch of different things at once.
Well, that's it for a jam-packed video segment tonight. On the next video segment, on the 30th, we'll have a compilation of your field day photos, plus another Show Me Your Shack. The club website of the week will return then also. Send your nominations, photos, and links to your video to HamNationVideos at twit.tv. All videos presented here are archived, and they're available for viewing anytime at hamnationvideos.info. So do tell your friends. Amanda's up next with questions from the chat room, but first, let's check in and find out about LegalZoom. And here's that lawyer from Louisiana, Mr. Don. Go ahead, Don.
No, not quite. Not quite. Let's not get into any of my legal problems. Thank you very much. If you got to plan for your future, that's what you've got to do. You've got to do some financial planning. You've got to get insurance. But to get real peace of mind, you have to make sure that your family and your finances are legally protected as well. So where do you turn for the legal help you trust? Well, it's LegalZoom.com. They've been helping Americans get personalized wills, powers of attorney, living trusts, and the like for over 13 years. LegalZoom will also help protect your assets with LLCs, S-corporations, trademarks, real estate documents, and a lot more. Now, LegalZoom was developed by some of the best legal minds in the country. They make it a painless process for you to get the legal protection that you need. Just go to LegalZoom.com. They'll take care of you from start to finish. It's the modern way to get legal help. Amazing what you can do with this technology these days. They've also received an A+ from the Better Business Bureau. Now, LegalZoom was developed by top attorneys to provide self-help services at your specific direction, but they're not a law firm. Legal help is furnished through vetted independent attorneys. Here's what you need to do. Visit LegalZoom.com, and if you go there and you use the offer code HamNation, you'll save on your legal needs and also get access to a network of legal plan attorneys for guidance. So protect your family, protect your future at LegalZoom.com now. Do it now. Use offer code HamNation. LegalZoom.com, offer code HamNation. You'll get $10 off at checkout. And LegalZoom, thank you so much for your support of Ham Nation. And Dale, thank you for the video segment. Awesome stuff. And thanks to all those people who spent countless hours shooting and editing and narrating and just getting out and operating field day. Just awesome stuff. Let's head over to Colorado now and see what's going on with Amanda and the chat room. What are they talking about tonight, Amanda?
Well, let's just say lots of videos, and I think everybody loved those videos, by the way, Dale. You did a great, great job. With that, let's first give congrats to a few upgrades and to a new licensee. I have W5 GTX and W4 EBC, who both just upgraded to Extra. Way to go.
Awesome.
And Sarah got her tech license on Thursday, and her new call sign is KD8ZDK. So congrats to you as well, Sarah. Glad to hear it. And you guys keep those coming for us. With that, I've got a couple of questions, George. First, somebody wants to know, what is that fancy-looking box below your LCD monitor?
That's a good question. That's applied engineering science. aes-rf.com. It's a digital reflectometer. It's a really nice meter here. It has a separate, I can't reach it, but a separate pickup unit in the rear there. You can put up to four of them on it. It shows you reflected and forward power and several different variations of it here, such as peak and I believe average. I have not hooked it up other than just put it on the bench here right now. I've got to hook it to my rig, but I'm out of room in the rack, so I've got to figure out how to handle that. But a really nice looking meter, and can't wait to try it out.
Okay, thanks, George, for that. And it sounds too technical for me, but I'm glad you can put it to good use. With that, one more question. KD2EPQ, Pierre has a dual-band mobile antenna, and the SWR is perfect on 2 meters, but when it goes down to 440, it's up to about 2 to 1 on the SWR. So is there anything he can do to keep it tuning flat on 2 meters while adjusting it for 70 centimeters? Oh, and he has a Comet CS790 antenna.
Okay, I didn't catch who you were addressing that to.
To you, George. I'm sorry.
Oh, to me. Okay, I should have been paying attention. yeah, you're going to have to kind of play with that antenna. You know, a lot of them, there's several different adjustments on them there, and you're just going to have to make small measurements and then check each band and see what happened to it. But, you know, I don't know of any good solution that would work across the board for that other than just trial and error.
You know, how old is the antenna? That's what I'm immediately, the question that comes to my mind is, has the antenna been on the car for a while? You might have some corrosion in there. It might be a good idea just to loosen all the Allen screws, take the antenna apart. Now, bear in mind to keep track of, you know, where the elements all go together on that mobile antenna, and just clean everything. Maybe get some Brillo pads, or if it's black anodized, you don't want to scratch that off, but get some rubbing alcohol or denatured alcohol and just clean everything really good and put it all back together and see if that helps. And worst case scenario, call the manufacturer.
Oh, that's a good one. Okay. Thank you, Don, for that extra info there. And, you know, I didn't get a lot of questions tonight, but I think everybody is still recovering from WRTC. I know I am. I tried to work those stations like crazy this weekend. Do you know how many I worked? 4. That's it. I don't think they were trying to work towards the Midwest. I do think they were trying to work overseas a whole lot more than they were here. But it was fun to hear everybody out there, and a lot of DX this weekend for the IARU as well. That was a great time. And I just want to, one more thing. Let me get Don's opinion first. Don, have you heard of the HR4969? And have you sent your senator a letter yet?
I have heard about that. Isn't it? That's the PRB1 bill, isn't it?
Yes. It's for the homeowners association, all that good stuff.
Right. I saw something on Facebook. In fact, the ARRL president Kay Craigie has a thing that is going around Facebook. Her appeal for people to absolutely call their senators and Congress people and get behind that. I saw a little bit of that earlier today. I didn't have time to listen to the whole thing, but yeah, that's something I'm definitely going to get behind.
Absolutely. And George?
Yeah, I hope it does pass. I don't hold out a lot of hope, unfortunately. These homeowners associations are, they pretty much got a death grip on the neighborhoods, it seems like. I had received something a week or so ago, and I can't remember where it was right now, but it was some kind of site for promoting agendas and such. And you'd go on there and say, yes, you support it. And then it would send you an email saying, well, you know, send us a donation and we'll tell more people about it. I don't think that's the best way to do it. But, yeah, that was probably not the only people trying to get the message out about that. But I sure hope it passes. It would help my son out a lot.
Yeah, living out in the country, I don't have to worry about those covenants and all that stuff. Even though I do live out in the country on 10 acres, I do have a restriction. I cannot raise pigs. I can be a ham, I just can't grow any.
What about
Tyler? Okay, you guys, I have I have one correction on the HR 4969. The ARRL is asking that you send your letter to your senator to them so that they can deliver them all themselves and have a nice discussion with them and maybe coax them a little bit more. So I,
great idea.
My correction, send it to the ARRL. They'll take care of it for you.
Great
with
idea.
That, I don't have anything else from the chat room except for everybody seems to be in a very chatty mode and happy, and weather is great everywhere, and everybody seems to be in good spirits. So nice to be here tonight. Let's send it back to you, Don.
Thank you, Amanda. An awesome job as always on the chat room. I'm glad you're with us. You do a wonderful job. And Dale, great job on the videos tonight. And of course, George, your smoke and solder continues to be the most popular thing on Ham Nation for good reason. Thank you for all the great work you do. Of course, Bob and Gordon are off in Connecticut. Thanks to Al and Mike tonight for joining us, the 40 meter and Ham Nation net controls. And of course, you can catch them tonight on 40 meters. And we also have the Echo Link, that is the Star Do Drop In Star conference server. And also on Reflector 14 Charlie, I believe, on D-Star, if you want to check into the D-Star net. So I think that probably, is the 20-meter net going? Do you know anything about the 20-meter net? Is it maybe the wrong time of the year for that? George, any info on that?
I believe it is going, Don. I have not seen the frequency in the chat room tonight, but I believe that one is going. I didn't see the frequency for the 40 meters tonight. Typically, these are around 7.278 for 40 meters. And 14.268 for 20 meters, but go up and down a little bit from those frequencies because there might have already been someone there when they started the net up.
Yeah. Neat video links, too, if you want to catch the Ustream stuff from Al and Mike and those 40-meter guys. It's either hamnation40.org or hamnation40.net. Just Google hamnation40 and you'll find it. Really, really neat website to watch as you monitor and check into the net.
It's hamnation40s.net, Don. It's also on hamsoncams.com. You can watch that stream, or you can watch it live on Ustream itself. So pretty neat thing to hear what you sound like in different parts of the country.
Yeah, that's the neat thing.
Stream it.
Yeah, and because of the latency, you actually get to go back and listen to yourself, which is really neat. I know when we were working the special event stations 2 years ago for the Ham Nation 100th episode, I worked Al and I got to listen to myself like 30 or 40 seconds later with the internet latency, and it was really neat to hear what your signal sounds like from across the country. So yeah, absolutely check that out. Well, guys, anything else? George, anything else from you tonight?
Well, I can confirm that the 20-meter net is on 14.268 because I hear Al, who was just here a few minutes ago, checking in himself, and he was saying he's going to go help out Mike on the 40-meter net. And Brad says it's around 7.272, but good to be back, everyone, this week, and look forward to seeing you all and Bob and Gordo next week, 7.3.
Absolutely. Thank you, sir. And if you're coming to the Slidell, Louisiana Ham Fest, I will see you and be coming from the VE test Saturday morning. We'll see if we can make some new hams. I can't raise them, but I can make them. Amanda, anything else from you tonight?
Not a lot, you guys, except for I will be on 40 to help out. I know I can't wait to hear Mike at only 100 watts. This is going to be funny. But anyhow, yep, I'll be there.
All right. And Dale, anything from you tonight to put the bow on it?
About the only thing there, Don, we'd like to see more videos. And since we couldn't fit the photos from Field Day in tonight, if they have some photos they'd like to get in, if they'll get them to us in the next week, in a week and a half, we'll get them on that compilation of Field Day photos also. And that's about it. Otherwise, good night from South Central Kansas.
All right. That'll do it for everybody. And for, of course, George and Bob, who are over there at the ARRL 100th, we'll say 7-3, good night, and thank you so much for watching Ham Nation, and we'll see you next week. Good night.